ready for the big intro.
I'm winded.
Holy cow.
Too much exercise, guys.
Whoa. It happens.
That's it. So much dancing.
So early in the morning.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning to everybody in the chat who are from all over the place. Well, there's a contradiction of opinions between Melissa's. Melissa, the guest, says it's too early for dancing, and Melissa in the chat says never too early for dancing. We'll leave you guys to duke it out in the chat. A dance contest, that's what we'll have. We'll have a dance-off on that.
A dance-off.
Oh, gosh. Yes. I will be the loser, for sure.
Oh, and Pete's got a baby dancing here, so that's very cool. Better than crying.
Oh, yep. Yeah. There you go. Baby dancing. So. Love it. The working from home skills.
Oh, folks, we have Melissa Milloway back with us again. She was with us last year. And if you haven't met Mel yet, and there's lots of hi Mels going on in the chat, so I think there are lots of folks who do know you from one angle or another who have joined us today. But Mel, give us a little bio of yourself. Tell us.
Oh, the music came back.
Whoa, encore. Encore.
Turned it off.
Hey, yeah, it's been a while. I'm super excited to be here with everyone, and so just catching up. So I'm Mel Milloway. I just previously was at Amazon. I'm on my third week at a company called Miro, and they have a whiteboard collaboration tool. It's really super cool. And I'm still doing learning experience design there. But the big difference, the big change is I'm now in customer education. So everything that I'm doing is customer facing. Whereas when I was at Amazon, it was all internal training for the most part.
Very cool.
And that is a huge separation in our industry, right? There is a lot of there's the split between the academics that do instructional design and the corporate people that do instructional design. And then within corporate, there is a split between the people who do instructional design and training for internal folks and the folks that do it for the external users and customers of products.
Yeah.
That's a good way to start it.
The learning umbrella, it goes deep and wide. And like, there's just so many possibilities for careers, I feel like.
Mm-hmm. It's a very large Venn diagram at times that things, you know, everything, so many of the pieces of what we do have overlaps with other things in other areas as well. As you were thinking about making this change then from internal to customer-based training, what kinds of things were on your mind in terms of like, I don't know, let's call them, you know, worries or thinking about, you know, what the challenges might be coming up in terms of making that shift.
Yeah. I guess first off, I can give like a little bit of background. I started to think about like transitioning to customer education probably like around this time last year. Oh, okay. And I had actually been like speaking with people at various companies, and I was like, I don't know, like it has to be the right opportunity, because I really was happy at Amazon, and like I love my team who's currently there. And so I was actually on a podcast, an internal podcast at Amazon for learning and development. And this is one that's done by like various people, like Kristen Anthony is a part of the podcast. And it was about career and like where you want to go in your career. And something that I was really missing was like, I was like, I love what I do now and like my team, but I can't see myself like doing this really long term. And so I started to like think about where I would want to go. So I picked sales enablement or customer education, because I think those are really areas that continue to trend upward right now. And I think it's a really good time to get into those areas. And to your question about like, what were my worries about moving over to those areas? I would say Amazon is so fast paced, and our base of users is huge. Like I was doing projects for potentially millions of people internally, because it's huge. So that wasn't so much a concern of mine. I think the concern is that the audience could potentially be so varied, right? Oh. So you're creating learning for everyone, anyone who could use a product or a tool or some or service or something like that. And so for me, I think it's adapting to thinking and really using that user research piece of things to be able to understand their goals and their needs. And I mean, it's external, so anyone can see it. There's a lot of different things like you have to consider. But I was just so excited because right now I think it's a really good time just for anyone in learning who wants to make the switch to make the switch, because the field's growing so much. And I think there's not that talent pool necessarily right now.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Yeah. The audience profile being, I mean, I guess in internally people you're maybe targeting more for a specific role, right? You know, people do this kind of a job, so they need this kind of information, et cetera. Whereas with an external audience, as you say, you don't know what they're using the tool necessarily for or what kind of work or context that they're using it in.
Yeah. I think there has to be more research around like who the users are, like what are the biggest needs, those types of things. Like internally, like you'll typically have a stakeholder come to you, or it's a part of like the business goals. Like we need to do XYZ for XYZ audience by, you know, like this date. So it's a little less ambiguous, I suppose.
Neat. Neato. Oh, Brent, we've lost your volume.
Yep. Sorry Brent, about that.
Brent went and touched that button. Brent touched the button that he wasn't supposed to touch.
It's a different button. There's too many buttons. Yeah. You mentioned getting that user information, right? And I often thought about that, how cool that would be, what a bonus it is for instructional designers, learning folks in dealing with audiences that are that vast, because you know that somebody, when they created the product, must have done some sort of user analysis, or you know, who are going to be the people that are going to use our product. So you get kind of a leg up, right? You get to see some of that documentation, or is that just a pipe dream of mine?
I feel like things are constantly changing with products. Like maybe your user base at one point starts with like a specific role, like engineers or something like that, but then expands as you add more features, or other people discover it and may encompass like other audiences as well, or even switch from like engineers to like a bigger audience. And I'm not talking specifically about like Miro, I'm just talking about like in general, like anything in customer education or a product or a service could change really quickly.
Amy's dropped a note in the chat. My daily wish and effort, getting that user profile and information. We find ways, lol. I feel that lol comes with maybe a bit of a wink or maybe even a, you know, facepalm going on too, maybe, depending on what people do. Are you able to I guess, share with like the things that your new role, where how folks are getting that information then about your user base? Like how do you, is it, are you guys doing surveys or how does that stuff end up getting gathered in?
Yeah. So I don't know how much I can speak to that right now. Mm-hmm. I'm going to be very cautious about that, but, but that is my part of my responsibility is really to work with the strategy on that. Like, how are we getting user feedback? How are we implementing that? What's a priority versus like not a priority, really coming up with what that looks like. So at Miro, I'm going to be leading the academy side of things. So our academy is this customer facing website where you can go and take courses and hopefully other like types of experiences coming up in this year. And then we also have like the in product side of things, and then our live training. So we've got webinars and things like that also happen. So there's a learning manager who focuses on each of those areas, and then our help center. So that would be a fourth one, which would be like a knowledge base.
Very cool.
What do you think, where do you think the overlap is between instructional design for internal versus external, if there is any, you think?
Yeah, I think there's differences and there's similarities. So I'm so new to customer education. So anyone who's watching this, who's been in customer education for a while, like take this with a grain of salt, definitely. There's a huge community out there for folks who are in customer education, who have people who've been in the industry for a really long time and know a lot more than me. But back to that question. So for instructional design, I think the differences are that, like, it's a little bit different because you're focusing on customers who are probably like purchasing something or buying something. So I think it's really important to focus on not just like their needs from an instructional design standpoint, what we want them to be able to do, but also like really focus on like the experience. Is it able to help them achieve that, what they want to be able to do or what they need to be able to do? And also there's like the want and need. So like, I think like a big thing with people in instructional design is like, we need to focus on the need, not what they're asking for. Like we need to figure out what they need. And I think there maybe needs to be a little bit more balance in that when you're on the customer education side of things. When you're internal, like you should definitely be that consultant. And I'm not saying you shouldn't be, but I think there has to be probably a little bit more balance. That's how I would see it. I don't know.
I'm creating a poll, so.
Oh, okay.
Oh,
so a poll, Chris, is happening.
We've never done a poll before.
I just saw the thing, and I'm like, "Ooh, this is a good time for a poll." But, carry on. It might take me a minute.
Yeah, I think the other thing about it too is you're not necessarily going to have like exact data to start with, like because you have so many different customers, right? So it's not going to be like, so we need to, you know, ramp up our like our call center agents to like have their average handle time go down by X percent or something like that. That's like super specific to like one company. So you really have to look at like the full picture. I guess unless you're actually like creating custom training for a specific company. Mm-hmm. So the goals would be varied, I suppose.
Yeah. Let me ask, you're now working in a new place. You're going to have to ramp up, I guess, on the new product itself. Do you have a sense of how long that's going to take you? Or maybe you've already hit that ramp up and ramped on.
Yeah, I've been using Miro for probably about a year now. So okay. I have been using it, maybe not to like its full extent, not like in an advanced way. There's a lot of integrations you can use with it, which is really cool. So like most recently, I use this tool called Adobe XD for like mockups and things like that for like website design. And that actually integrates with Miro. So you can click a button and it brings in your artboards from Adobe XD into Miro, and you can leave like comments and like do like sticky notes like around things, or you can do just various things. So there's just so many use cases for it. The funnest thing that I've done so far is that our team had a team meeting recently, and I was tasked to create an icebreaker. And I know some people cringe over icebreakers. I love icebreakers. I don't force people to do them. I'm like, do it if you want to do it. But I created these art boards like in the tool itself. And I put a little pixelated house with a little pixelated fence and a green background. And I asked people to design their dream backyard. And so using Miro, people would go in. I said, like, you can use emojis or you can do like the Google image search like integration in the tool. And people would put like a pool. And then I put like a grill and a chicken coop because I really want to like have chickens one day. And so I had people go and do that in 10 minutes. And then everyone went around for like 2 minutes and said like what was in their backyard and why. So there's just like, there's so many things you can do with the tool. And so, I don't know, I'm just excited to come up with not so much learning how to use the tool, but like the different things you can do with the tool.
Yeah, I guess there are the specific functionalities of where buttons and things are, but there's that actual extension of, you know, the concentric circles of application that go outside of just, yeah, how to save, how to start, how to do those sorts of things.
Yeah.
Gang, let's, everybody, if you wouldn't mind, gang, just in the chat, just jump to the poll, toss in your, make a selection there. Tell us a little bit. We're test driving this polls thing. That's going to be kind of fun.
Ooh.
I'm not a very good poll creator, so bear with me, everyone.
So is the question, did they switch like industries?
Or just switch from doing internal employee training to customer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, we'll see if anybody else has got a similar experience, either one direction or the other way, I guess.
Yeah, maybe we should start referring to it as customer employee education versus customer education. That's a little bit more clear, I think, in the differences. Mm-hmm. And just so everybody knows, Mel is in customer education, despite the fact that I said she's in customer experience.
Well, I was part of the problem because I kept saying CE, and you know how we love acronyms, like just in general in business. So I got a little carried away with my usage of acronyms.
Yeah, that's all right. I assumed incorrectly that CE meant customer experience, but no, that's CX. The acronym gods were against me.
The interpretation of acronyms, it's a science of its own.
It is.
That could be a whole other show.
Yeah, right.
Oh, yeah.
Look, we got a lot of people thinking about making the switch. It's mm-hmm. it's interesting. It's very curious that so many people see it as an opportunity. Were there other elements besides just kind of wanting a change or seeing the growth in it yourself that made you want to switch over?
Yeah, definitely. Like when I was on that podcast and people were asking me about what I wanted to do next, like the one thing I kept thinking of was just how my favorite role of all time that I've ever had was at Janssen Pharmaceuticals. It's a Johnson & Johnson, like the pharmaceutical branch of things. And I was in sales training there, which I guess is now called sales enablement. And I don't know when I like missed that bus, but I missed that bus at some point. And I was like, I was in sales training. They're like, sales training? That's like, No one says that anymore.
That's some 1990s. Come
on. but that was my favorite role. And I was like, there is such a difference between, I think, customer education and sales and like doing internal training for like employees, like say like in, I don't know, in various areas, like the energy level. I thrive on like good, like positive, like I love like big energy. And when I was in pharmaceuticals, like everyone was jazzed every single day. And it was just like, let's get this done. Like, people were so positive and like just wanting to do things. And when I made the switch over to other areas other than sales, like it just kind of felt like, yeah, like let's do it. Like, it didn't feel like I missed that energy. And I definitely feel that again, like in customer education, like it feels like we're doing big things and everyone's really excited to do them.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting. Jill has a question in the question panel that sort of echoes that. Do you find it more challenging to create materials for customers who have to want to participate in training versus internal where they might be assigned the training? So that level of intrinsic, extrinsic motivation maybe. And how do you change your approach between those two?
Yeah, that's a really great question. So how do you like the difference between people like being assigned something versus people like trying, like going and doing it themselves? And so I really prefer the latter, like the assignment piece, like, and it's really interesting because when I was at Amazon, it would be both, right? Like some things we would assign and some things would be more so like, we're creating this thing for you to enable you to do something. You don't have to use it, but we would want you to use it, right? And so the projects that I loved the most when I was working at Amazon, so I worked on like a lot of work authorization projects that would help people be able to like start their roles on time, because if they didn't fill out the documents right, like potentially they couldn't start their job, or maybe not even, they wouldn't even be able to, you know, ever start their job. So the projects that I really enjoyed were the ones where I was creating like the materials to enable people to be able to do that, and to make them delightful and enjoyable. So for me, like I lean more towards like, I want to help people who want to be helped more than anything. Like I want to help people like with their problems and their goals. And so I think like that feels way more rewarding to me than forcing someone to do something that they don't necessarily want to do, or to tick a box like compliance training. So that didn't necessarily answer your question in regards to like what's necessarily easier or harder. I definitely think like it's less enjoyable to create training on something that people don't want to do.
It's way more fun to see that light bulb go off, right? I mean, that's the thing that's kind of fun about when you are in that position of being able to show somebody something new and then they go, oh, I'm totally going to go try that.
Yeah.
You know, that's that energy, right? That you're talking about. It. So when people are invested going into the training that you're creating or offering to them, or just the instruction, whatever it is, when you're helping them, they're eager to learn. And so they're locked in and they're wanting to know what you have to say. Internal onboarding, you know, it's like blah 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 blah.
I mean,
blah, blah.
there's positives. There's positives about like compliance type training too, where like you want people to come away with it and say, I got to take that training. That was the best compliance training I ever had to take.
Yeah, like, if you can pull that off, if you're allowed to, right? I mean, everybody complains about that. You know, they don't let us have any fun in that class. I have to, somebody else designed it and I have to deliver it and it's really boring and it's lame. And
I think the ultimate thing for like anyone in our industry, regardless of like if you're internal, external, whatever, is that you want people to say, I got to do that, not I had to do that. Like I think that's something that's super important to make people feel that way, not feel like it's a chore.
Or at least at a minimum that I learned something, or it was helpful, or it was, you know, relevant, which so often compliance type stuff, because the nature of the content is, I mean, we do have to do it every year, et cetera. So you see it as a chore and you just want to get it done and out of the way. I wonder if you've been experiencing this yet, that I think there's a lot of potential for training externally for, I'm going to use the word tone, but for that to reflect, let's call it the you know, company, you know, personality, or
the
maybe
brand and voice.
Yeah. And I'm going to say maybe even more personality than maybe internal training, where we tend to be, I'm going to speculate, but there's so many reasons why, but by the time all the SMEs get through everything, there's a sense of voice that can often be, you know, tamped down, and we end up focusing on. So are you experiencing that sense, that is that a difference that you're experiencing yet?
That's definitely very different. That's definitely very different. And I think I know, especially with like internal training, and if you're doing more on the compliance side of things, which I would say like on the compliance side, like I was probably doing 20% of that in my previous role, but with that, like legal's looking at everything with a fine tooth comb, and they're saying like, you can't use that word, like you can't do that. Like you have to be very cognizant of every single word you use. I would say that is definitely very different. And I guess it also depends on like the company's brand and voice. So if you're doing external training, like what is their brand of voice? Because if you're doing external stuff for, say, something like in healthcare or something, like you probably, maybe a little different. I don't know.
It's not appropriate to be fun necessarily, you know, in the same way that for maybe product training or something. Yeah. Taruna's got a note in the chat. Strange but true. I could innovate more easily when designing customer training and when the organization was being paid for it. I encountered more friction as I tried new things when designing employee training. Yeah, there are more layers, certainly for things like compliance and regulatory training, for sure, that affect that kind of, you know, I don't know, let's call it voice and tone and fun, et cetera. Yeah. Milan is pointing out in the questions that there is no I do both option in the poll.
Oh.
It's true. You can definitely be doing both for sure.
Yeah. And he throws in an actual question as well. What do you think about recycling internal content and using it for externals? Is there anything you would avoid if you want to transform?
Frozen. Uh-oh. Chris, we lost Chris.
I'm going to just flick the screen. Shake him loose. There we go.
Am I back yet?
Oh, yep,
am I
there back? You are. See, you just had to there flick it.
That was so weird. You guys froze on me. Did you lose my audio as well, or just my...
Yeah, both.
Yeah, we lost you. But you're back. It's all good. Oh, well, maybe it's not good.
Oh, he was like in slow motion there for a second. What was his question?
Oh, I'll read it. Oh, you're back. Okay.
Okay. Yeah, I was just trying to add in the question that Milan was asking in the chat about, you know, opportunities, I guess, for recycling or crossing over from internal content and external content.
Yeah, I haven't. So I would imagine that there is probably some of that out there. It's not something that necessarily like I have experienced. So it's not something like I could talk to. But I would say there's probably like in my previous role and previous like roles, there's probably some like overlap. So I'm trying to think, like I used to do training for Amazon logistics for delivery stations, right? And so like there would be flex drivers, the people who come and like pick up the packages. They're not employees, they're just like, you know, completely separate. But there might be things like we were doing internally, like on best like safety practices, like for like, you know, internal drivers that you may apply to like external people or something like that. I'm not saying that happened, but like I could see where there would be similarities, so you could pull for those types of things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Are there, you mentioned early on, and I just kind of wanted to circle back to it, like some of the fears, there can't be too many fears because it sounds like you've sort of done this before, but is there anything that you're really concerned about or maybe on the flip side, excited about? I mean, you kind of already mentioned the exciting part, but like what, is there something that, you know, obviously it's new job, so.
You
don't want to be like, I'm totally freaked out to come work for you guys. I guess.
No, I'm not honestly, to be honest, like I think, I don't know. I keep saying this to people, like anytime that you start something new or there's a big change, like there's going to, you have to have the conversation with yourself that it's okay not to know a lot right away. And it's okay to it be in question asking mode and discovery mode and not solutioning mode. Like I am the type of person who wants to like immediately jump to solutioning for things, but sometimes you just need more information and you need to have a little bit more background or have the right people on your side to help you to do that. And so like, I think it's not necessarily like I'm worried about something. It's more so I need to remind myself, like it will, like I'll get there. And I onboarded quite a few people to my team when I was at Amazon. And so I've seen like a lot of people go through that. So it's very fresh in my mind. And so I feel very comfortable. I'm not saying like I'm confident, but I feel very comfortable that I'm going to get there.
That's good. Well, you've got a lot of experience under your belt now, so it should, yeah, you're going to be awesome.
And and what I'm excited about, because that was the other question, what I'm super excited about is getting to use all these skills that I haven't necessarily been like using, because there's a big, like, I think opportunity just in customer education side for like bringing in like social media and, you know, doing more with like different things, like maybe gamification or like playing around with other things that would benefit like the customers in that space. So I think that I'll get to use a lot of like the skills that like I haven't been necessarily flexing day to day, which I'm very excited about.
So did you see our episode with Mike Tolfson?
I didn't. Microsoft? I didn't.
You've got to see it, and you've got to go check out his TikTok. He teaches people how to use Microsoft Teams because he's part of the program. He's the program director for that, for Teams, I think, is what he said. Jeez, I could be wrong now. Sorry, Mike. One of those things over there. But he has a TikTok that has just totally blown up.
Oh, really? And, yeah. I have to check this out.
It's super cool. And he started off with a YouTube, and then he started duplicating it over to TikTok. But yeah, you definitely watch what he's doing. He'll be the first to tell you he's not a pro. He just started doing it just kind of for fun. But yeah, I mean, I see that kind of stuff as a great opportunity for, you know, instructional designers and for, you know, educators in general to now finally be able to see those external tools that we all sometimes kind of talk about, but we never get a chance to use. So when you're dealing with external customers now, it's like, this might be an opportunity to do that.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. And I think there's like there is a time and a place for everything. Like short videos and things like that are good at maybe like teaching like one specific like skill within like a greater scope of things. And like I think the longer like materials, like as we know, like are for like maybe learning for the first time to give more context, to get the why behind like not just the buttonology, especially with projects, the buttonology of things like, click here to like move this. Yeah, it's actually, it's like a real term. Like if you Google buttonology, it's like, it's just, it's software training on just how to use the software, not why you're doing the things in the software. Like, why would I use this versus this in the software, not how to use it. So I think there's like more, for like longer in-depth trainings there, that's better. But then the shorter TikTok type things are good for potentially like those types of things, smaller things.
I threw a link to the episode into the chat for anybody that wants to go to see that. You know, one of the things that he mentioned was that what he was finding with the very short time frame available in TikTok was he would do a little thing about something that might have actually existed in a product for 20 years, but people still didn't know about
mystery.
It.
So it's, you
know, little feature. Things. So it wasn't even sort of like, we have new features rolling out. Here's, he would do little TikToks about things that he's always known and going, oh, well, here's how you, you know, here's how you do this. And he said the response that people would, you know, have to something that's been there for so long, but they'd never discovered it before was actually part of the, I think the charm, I think he was, would suggest of the success of the TikTok was that kind of stuff. So,
I love that. I'm going to watch that one.
Yeah, it's fun. So you got a lot of options ahead of you. Do you see yourself sticking around in the customer education field for a while?
I definitely do. As of right now, I'm on week three, so I feel very positive about it right now. And it's definitely like an area that I'd like to remain in. I did have a little bit of like that imposter syndrome. Can I even get over to this role, like move into this space? Like, is this something like that if I interview, like, am I just going to completely like tank it and like not get it? And like, people should not worry about that. Like, you should not worry about that. Like, you should look at the job description, see where your strengths are, and then, you know, come up with things that for the other areas that like, where you could grow in and like have a plan for that and just like apply if you're like interested. Because when I'm seeing in the customer education, like Slack, is there's like a jobs channel, and I swear there's at least 5 jobs posted every day. It seems like, so the field's growing, but there's not enough people who have even been in customer education to fill the roles. So, so instructional design, I feel like could or is a perfect like area to transition from into that.
Yeah, I absolutely think you're right. I mean, and it's all because of the software as a service model, right? I mean, I don't want to go too into the weeds on the whole business side of things, but over the last 10 years, talking to different CEOs and VPs of product companies and whatnot, the whole business model switching from, you know, software in boxes where people actually like bought a product and had it on their desktop versus software as a service changed the whole business model. And part of that business model and making money is keeping customers, right? Once you get a customer, you have to keep the customer and keep them happy. And part of keeping them happy is teaching them how to be successful using the product. So there was this natural, holy crap, we got to find some people to help keep our customers happy. You know, our current, like the support staff isn't enough. We can't just be reactionary. We need to be proactive, right? And provide all sorts of stuff to help people be successful.
Yeah,
and I think that shift just kind of quietly happened over, you know, the last 5 to 10 years, and hence made these new career opportunities, which is pretty obvious from that poll. I think that a lot of people are, you know, thinking about, wow, maybe that is a good place for me to go use my instructional design skills.
Yeah. But, and it's interesting too, because we see a lot of teachers now also making the switch to instructional design. So you kind of see everyone's switching it up a little bit. I noticed this year with COVID and everyone working from home, just like a mass influx of teachers posting on LinkedIn on like, how do I move over to this field? Like, so it seems like everyone's making switches.
Mm-hmm. Indeed.
Yeah. There's... lots of shifts because of the past year's factors for sure.
Do you ever sit and think, or did it ever cross your mind? Like, I don't know how much you think through the theories of instructional design and like all that stuff you learned from Dr. Kopp in your master's program and all that kind of stuff. Do you ever sit and think, okay, how am I going to apply those instructional design theories and things in customer education? Or are you at that point where you've just been doing it for so long, you just kind of are rolling with it?
I would say it's the latter. It's something that like, it's kind of ingrained after you're doing it for such a long time. And the folks on my team are so talented. And they also have like those backgrounds too. It's, we're just all talking the same lingo and we're like, okay, like let's align this with like Bloom's taxonomy. And like, how do we want to measure this? And like, it's stuff you just kind of say, and you're not like actively, I don't know. It's just a part of, and asking a lot of questions and like trying to really understand the needs of the learner. Like, I think, yeah, I don't know. I would say it's more ingrained than anything. I just saw Will Thalmer post on like LinkedIn on what was it? Dale's Cone. Dale's Cone.
The cone of shame.
Yeah, the cone of shame. And just because like I'm in another area doesn't mean like I'm not reading about instructional design or reading about different things. And a big part of like our role, like as people in learning, regardless of customer education or not, is to also, you know, help to inform our stakeholders on like, what does learning look like? Like what is learning? Like we were talking about like the debunking, like the learning myths, like learning styles myths. And so I also saw someone on my team, like do a presentation and they were helping like internal folks, like understand like the learning styles myth and like how people learn. And so I would say that's pretty similar, right? Like we're doing that regardless of if we're internal, external, we're helping to bring people along in what learning is, because everyone has assumptions. Everyone's the expert.
Well, we all experienced learning by going to school in a certain model and watching, you know, there was someone at the front of the room throwing knowledge at us and sometimes pieces of chalk. So that's, you know, we all know what a teacher does or what a, you know, an instructor does. So.
Yeah, now there's a whole generation that knows about virtual online learning. And so it's only going to take about 20 years before it becomes normal.
maybe one last sort of topic area to dip into, but what's the relationship between, say, the customer education group that you're working with right now and marketing? Is there like, are those two departments connected in a formal way? Or because I mean, they're both looking to talk to the same kinds of people, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. And I would say just in general, like for customer education, because I've been lurking on their Slack channel for a while, what I see with customer education teams and other like internal teams, I see people in customer education with content, with customer success people, with marketing and brand. I'm trying to think of like what else and other like areas of the business. Like, I think it's the same, like there's those close cross-functional relationships because we're helping each other. And it's like internal, it's similar. It may not be with marketing, but it may be with like another area of the business. So it's just identifying like who are going to be the like players or whatever, who are going to be helping each other in that area. So like in HR, like maybe it's like, you know, you're working with like recruiting closely. I don't know. Like it's, I think it's just like another side of the coin. It's just different stakeholders.
Yeah. And so, but structurally, is your group reporting to the same place as marketing, or are those almost like, you know, different parts of the org chart? Have you found that, you know, does the marketing influence the customer education in any way?
Yeah, I don't know. That's a really great question. And that would be a really good one for me to post to the customer education folks, not in my org, but like just in general to see like how they're rolling up like within their own organizations. Yeah. Like that would be quite interesting. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know if I'm allowed to talk about our org structure, so that's why I'm avoiding answering that. Yep. Like, I'm totally one of those people, okay. I'm like, I will answer as much as I like. I'm like, I don't know. Like, it's always what can I talk about?
What are you going to do with your, the newsletter that you started that got so incredibly popular with This Side Up?
Yeah, This Side Up. Yeah. So I'm going to continue that. And I think like, because I'm new to customer education, I don't want to write about like deep things in customer education. I might talk a little bit about my like personal journey. I don't want to put myself as like any kind of expert because I am not an expert. I might just talk about my journey, but I'm also going to continue talking about like what I've learned as a manager for like the past almost like 3 years. And also just like some learning technology stuff as well. Like I want to keep writing about that too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's going to be interesting with, having that manager role and having a team around you that thinks the same way you do, right? You can have those conversations, kind of changes the whole game. Is, you know, you don't have to go in and educate everybody on all the things, right? That's on your team, and you can just, you know, you can get in there and everybody's on the same page, and you can just kind of start going for it, you know, from that opening, you know, bell as soon as you start. Sounds like you got a great, great spot.
Definitely.
Yeah. We have a couple of folks in the chat that picked up on that marketing angle. So Winnie is noting, we work closely with marketing, but we're different teams. We work with them to align on branding, messaging, and product value props. And that was kind of what I was thinking was, the value propositions that are implicit in a sales conversation and in a marketing program are also the things that people need to know about how to do as part of being, you know, upskilled on a tool for sure. And Sarah's noting, my team also works closely with marketing and product marketing, but aren't in the same team. And Kathy's noting, seems like there are even different flavors of customer education, individual consumer versus enterprise types of products too. So lots of different angles in
and
the
services.
Mix,
yeah.
And services too. Yeah.
There's so mm-hmm. many different things.
Mm-hmm. Does Miro have an enterprise version that they sell like mass licenses into big companies?
There's different plans. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's not just an individual thing.
Yeah. I mean, you could definitely like anyone can use it, right? Like anyone can just go use it right now. But there are enterprise.
Well, super cool. I am looking forward to, can we have you come back in like, you know, next year, our next season? We always take August off. And so this is kind of we are approaching the end of this season of Idiotic. So maybe towards the end of the actual calendar year or something like that, we can have you back. And you can tell us more about what you've learned and where you're at. How about that?
Yeah, absolutely. I will be stoked to look back and see, like, was I wrong about everything that I said last time?
No, I think it's great. I really appreciate you being so candid with us and coming and sharing your skills and, you know, all the things you do for the industry have been so fantastic. It's it's been fun watching you grow in your career ever since you first got out. Oh my gosh, every time I see him, I can't help but think of an Ewok. Mm. He's so cute.
I forgot to bring him last time, so I'm showing him this time. This is my dog, ZD.
And you can follow ZD on her Instagram because she doesn't post anything but ZD on her Instagram.
He also has his own. I'm that person. Really? Yeah.
Oh, I did not know that. Okay, I'll have to follow him there. Because my dog will want to hang out with him probably.
Another sign that things have changed over the past year of pandemic and people working from home, every meeting's got to have a dog or a cat, right? It does.
And what do you do without our animals keeping us sane, right? Well, this was super fun. Mel, if you got an extra hand while you're holding the doggy, drop in your count information, all that kind of stuff, and let people know where they can get a hold of you and stay connected. And it's been so fun to watch your career and to see you make a shift like this is really super fun. So thanks for hanging out and sharing with us.
Yeah. You're welcome. Thanks
as well to everybody in the chat. Awesome stuff going on there and in the question panel too. Thanks so much for participating today, gang. We'll catch you guys all next week. Don't forget to sign up before you leave for the next session.
And don't forget to join us inside of the idiotic group inside of LinkedIn.
Yep.
Yeah, we hang out there and we try to share some Q&A and some thoughts after each one of these sessions. So come and join us and hang out and, heck, have a good time. Unfortunately, there's no music playing inside of the LinkedIn group. But
no, bring your own playlist, but you can dance. Yeah. You can still dance.
Speaking of that, let's do it. Let's dance. Thanks again, Alex.